Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants for whom Christ, your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes, we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny when he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people? A grave was assigned him among the wicked, and a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood, but the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Into your hands I commend my spirit. In you, Lord, I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your justice, rescue me. Into your hands I commend my spirit. You will redeem me, O Lord, O faithful God. Of reproach, a laughing stock to my neighbors, and a dread to my friends. Those who see me abroad flee from me. I am forgotten like the unremembered dead. I am like a dish that is broken. My trust is in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. In your hands is my destiny. Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your kindness. Take courage and be stout-hearted, all you who hope in the Lord.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, Since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus the Nazarene."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was the gatekeeper said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made, because it was cold, and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there, keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret, I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
"You are not one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said,
"Didn't I see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him,
"If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have the right to execute anyone."
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priest handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king."
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him. But you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?
They cried out again.
Not this one, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said,
Hail, King of the Jews.
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And he said to them,
Behold the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered,
We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium, and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you, and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar.
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
Behold your king.
They cried out,
Take him away, take him away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read this inscription, because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews.
Pilate answered,
What I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another,
Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be.
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
Woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
Behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
There was a vessel filled with common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
It is finished.
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Now, since it was Preparation Day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first, and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs, but one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus. And Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial customs. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish Preparation Day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Among the many Lenten devotions recommended by the Church, the Stations of the Cross are perhaps the most familiar. I still remember going with my parents to Stations on Friday nights in my home parish during Lent. And that moment has fostered my own devotion to the Stations of the Cross. Born out of a widespread devotion to the Passion of Jesus in the 12th and 13th centuries, the Stations of the Cross began to develop as a devotion when the Franciscans were granted custody of the Christian sites in Jerusalem in 1342. However, from the earliest days of Christianity, pilgrims have journeyed to Jerusalem to walk in the footsteps of our Lord on the road to Calvary. Tradition holds that after the ascension of Jesus into heaven, the Blessed Mother herself, led by example in making daily visits to the sites of her son's suffering, death, and resurrection. More than 2,000 years later, pilgrims to the Holy Land walk the Via Crucis through the old city of Jerusalem as part of their pilgrimage. The Stations of the Cross are meant to assist the faithful in appreciating the gift of salvation that Jesus gave us on Good Friday as we meditate on the death of Jesus on the cross. Although there are various publications of the Stations of the Cross, my favorite is the one composed by St. Alphonsus Liguori in 1761. You may be familiar with his conclusion to each station. I love you, Jesus, my love, more than I love myself. Grant that I may love you always, and then do with me what you will. In his introduction to the Stations, St. Alphonsus writes, "The pious exercise of the way of the cross represents the sorrowful journey that Jesus Christ made with the cross on his shoulders to die on Calvary for the love of us. We should, therefore, practice this devotion with the greatest possible fervor, placing ourselves in spirit beside our Savior as he walked this sorrowful way, uniting our tears with his, and offering to him both our compassion and our gratitude." Traditionally, the Stations of the Cross are accompanied by the singing of the Stabat Mater, originally a Latin hymn written in the 14th century. The hymn begins with the stanza, "At the cross her station keeping, stood the mournful mother weeping, close to Jesus to the last." Composed of 20 verses, the Stabat Mater evokes the pain and the grief of Our Lady standing at the foot of the cross as she watches her son being crucified for the redemption of the world. The Stabat Mater focuses on the spiritual and emotional bond which unites Mary and all Christians to the death of her son on the cross, and invites us to contemplate the mother who suffers as Our Lady enters into the most challenging moment of her life, witnessing the execution of her only son. I cannot help but think of the inexpressible grief of too many mothers today who suffer the loss of their children through gun violence in schools and on our streets, as well as those countless mothers who have lost their sons because of war, most notably today, the war in Ukraine. Let us also remember that Russian mothers have also lost their sons. All of these women are like our Blessed Mother. They too are the mournful mother weeping. in the Passion account today. John the Evangelist tells us, standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. Speaking on this gospel passage, St. John Paul II observed, at the end of his earthly life, as he addresses his mother and the disciple he loved, the crucified Messiah establishes a new relationship of love between Mary and Christians. The reality brought about by Jesus' words, that is, Mary's new motherhood in relation to the disciple, is a further sign of the great love that led Jesus to offer his life for all people. On Calvary, this love is shown in the gift of a mother, his mother, who thus becomes our mother too. On this Good Friday, we all stand with Mary at the foot of the cross. We contemplate the cross. We see it through her eyes. We identify with her shadowing experience of grief. Mary stood there for hours just to be with her son. And today, on this Good Friday, and in the martyrdom of our own lives, Mary stands beside us. As St. Bernard of Clairvaux teaches, Mary holds our hand, and therefore we cannot fall. Under her protection, we have nothing to fear. Mary holds each of us. We are all under her protection. She takes us by the hand in the midst of our own grief, sorrow, struggles, disappointments, and whatever crosses we must carry. With a mother's love, Mary consoles and comforts us. With Mary at our side, we have nothing to fear. As Jesus entrusted John, the beloved disciple, to Mary's care, he also entrusted each of us to her care. Just like every child has a special place in the heart of their mother, so we have a special place in the heart of Mary, our mother. Here in Mary's shrine, we have a visual testimony of this reality. In chapel after chapel, we encounter Our Lady through her devotions, apparitions, titles, and ethnicities. Each is a reminder of the care that Mary has had for her children around the world and throughout the centuries. Then we look up to the Trinity Dome and see Our Lady of the Immaculate Conception with her outstretched arms, gathering all of us, all of her children, together to herself. recall, too, the words of Our Lady to Juan Diego at Guadalupe. Is it not I, your mother, who is here? Are you not under my protection? Are you not in my care? On this Good Friday, Mary looks upon each of us, embraces each of us, her sons and daughters, as we stand with her at the foot of the cross. We are in her care today and every day. Our Lady never abandons her children. She always stands with us.
At the cross her station keeping, stood the mournful mother weeping, close to Jesus to the last.
May the cross of Jesus strengthen us in temptation, sustain us in trial, redeem us in our sufferings, and give us hope when hope seems lost. And may Mary, our mother, keep us close to Jesus to the last.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout all the world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church, to govern the holy people of God.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our Bishop Wilton, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that, having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth to gather them together and keep them in his one church.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who gathered what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith, and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that, enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love, and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that, following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always, by desiring you and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will for the true peace and freedom of all.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples. Look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of people, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray for the people in Ukraine and in all war zones of the world, for those who have fled the horror of violence and have been deprived of their homes, for all women and men who stand up with their lives to ward off evil and to protect the weak and the persecuted.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, have compassion for the lowly and the poor, but you cast down oppressors. As you guided Israel out of Egypt, so in our days, save all victims of war and violence. Change the hearts of evildoers, and let peace be victorious through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us
behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us
behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Of our banner and dear.
Today's collection is to help in the preservation of the shrines of the Holy Land and to assist persecuted Christians in a strife-torn region. These shrines continue to inspire those who are privileged to follow in Christ's footsteps and serve as reminders of the good news of the gospel for all the world. Thank you for your generous sacrifice to this special collection.
Thank you.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours now and forever.
May the receiving of our body and blood, Lord Jesus Christ, not bring me to judgment and condemnation, but through your loving mercy, be for me protection in mind and body and a healing remedy. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not ready in the kitchen of the world, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Bow down for the blessing.
May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure through Christ our Lord.